We are on Pacific Island number 407, almost directly upon the equator, where the Earth's spin is at its maximum. The lazy quiet of this beautiful tropical place is being violated by the hubbub of scientific activity as we make last-minute preparations for man's first voyage to outer space. Minus 120 seconds. Hatches are closing. Hatches are closed. Minus 100 seconds. The rocket is poised and we're cradled in acceleration couches. Minus 80 seconds. Soon a spasm of flame will hurtle us into the heavens toward an incredible island in the sky. The orbital spaceport, Terminus Terra 1. Minus 60 seconds. Minus 50. Seven, six, five, four, three, two, one. We watch the curving mass of the Earth dropping away. The sky changes from dawn gray to blue to purple, finally deepening into intense black. The sight is indescribable. The stars are brighter and the void is blacker than we've ever known. There's neither up nor down. Stars are on all sides of us, as if we were in the very center of the cosmos.
Oh.
We are in weightless free fall, entering the orbit of the man-made satellite. Space Station, Terminus Terra 1. The spaceport looks like a weird collection of geometrical structures floating unconnectedly in a sea of nothingness. Immense silver disks and spheres and cylinders. Lying alongside motionless is the great interplanetary spaceship which we will board for our journey into deep space. For this is the transfer point to other worlds. Our rocket warps close to the largest structure, and a fabric-covered tube snakes out toward us. Airlocks are activated, and we make our way by pulling ourselves along handholds into a pressurized interior of the spherical depot. Inside, we find installations for servicing and refueling spacecraft, and complex equipment for astronautics and communications. The artificial atmosphere brings sound to life, and it all becomes an oasis of noise in an ocean of silence. Days out from Earth. And now close ahead is Venus, planet of mystery, guarding her secrets beneath a dazzling white cloak of bright clouds. This is the new frontier. What lies behind those clouds? Is there life? And if there be life, what manner of living things will we encounter? We are on the surface and have left the ship. We are lost in mist. Gradually, we feel as if we are suspended in the air. It is like a pleasant dream in which we are lying upon a cloud that bends and folds, conforming to our body, holding it securely, but so softly and gently that we cannot feel the structure of that which embraces us. A steadily increasing glow seems to emanate from everywhere. Perception is confused. We cannot be sure whether we're actually hearing or experiencing something telepathically.
Welcome, friend.
Peculiar rays of shifting light cause grotesque and eccentric shadows to dance and play upon a nebulous substance which solidifies into form and as quickly dissolves into spiraling vapors, glowing and vibrating with tints and colors never seen before. They slowly focus into value and relationship. And we are looking at a woman. She is small and dainty and startlingly beautiful. She's gowned in a luminescent and diaphanous material which flows and clings to her body. Her eyes and hair and soft, smooth flesh are of ever-changing hues, sometimes delicate, sometimes vibrant and brilliant. Suddenly, we are in the midst of a crowd of wondrous creatures. Men and women and children. They seem to mix and intermix and flow into one another. Male becoming female, and female becoming male, and child becoming adult, and aged becoming young. Changing and changing back again in the phantasmagoria of warm and friendly beauty. All at once, we're being carried in a welcoming procession. It is happy and festive.
Thank you.
Our new friends are amused by our method of rocket travel, which they consider primitive. No longer bound by the restrictions of half-learned truths, among other stupendous accomplishments, they've perfected a magical way of travel. They've learned to dematerialize their bodies and go wherever they want without the means of physical transportation. Flights of spirit alone, but real flights in which they literally roam anywhere in the cosmos without limitations of time, speed, or distance. And even more remarkable, they're able to lend us techniques so that we may be able to go along on one of these fabulous excursions. Out into the great distances we go. Out into the spiraling galaxies. Out into other universes so vast that it takes 100,000 years and more for light just to cross them. Blinding skies aflame with mammoth swirling clouds of eruptive incandescent gases, gathering and eddying, rolling and billowing, turning and twisting, and leaping out in unending tongues of whirling, writhing fire. Out to the regions of the other suns, dull red giant suns, and unbelievably dense white dwarf suns, thousands of times hotter than our own, where double stars and Systems of multiple stars and immense swarms of stars have clusters of other worlds orbiting around them. Swift celestial fragments streaking across the vacuum toward nowhere in particular. The meteors and comets, the wanderers of space. All over the heavens, above, below, beyond, billions and billions of other stars shining in every color of the spectrum, gold and turquoise and sapphire and topaz and emerald, brilliant gems in seas of blackness. Thank you. The hour comes for our return to Earth, and as we blast off into the stillness of the spatial seas, we try to understand something of what we have seen.
Look up, look up!